My name is Bill Klett. I'm a migratory beekeeper and queen breeder, working in Southeast Texas and North Dakota. Been at it for about 45 years, I guess. Yeah. Presently run about 2,000 hives with my son and his significant other and my wife. Any other willing volunteers? There are three big problems particular to beekeeping. One is just loss of habitat. Bees, like all other animals, need a variety of nutritional sources. So whereas once upon a time there were endless flowers and in a great variety, now a lot of the land is, you know, monocropped with all corn, all soybeans, all cotton, whatever, you know. It's so, and then it's that leads you into the second big problem, which is chemistry. Agricultural chemicals get sprayed on all kinds of stuff, you know, pesticides, fungicides. You know, like, give you one example. A few years ago, somebody took some samples of pollen that bees were gathering up somewhere in the Midwest. I don't know. Might have been in the Dakotas or Minnesota or Iowa. I don't know. They analyzed it, you know, a bunch of these pollen samples. And on average, there would be 25 different agricultural chemicals present in the pollen, you know. So that's what they're eating, you know. And basically, that's what we're eating, too. It's into all of our food, too. You know, so that's another issue affecting bee health. There's so much being applied to the land to kill undesirable insects, which inadvertently kill the good ones too, right? You know, so this is one of the biggest problems we have. Is maybe with all the CRISPR technology that's coming on, you know, and, you know, genetics, they might be able to fine tune and, you know, eventually target specifically the organism that they want to get. You know, without, you know, you're trying to kill some kind of a weevil that's getting into your crop, then, you know, the bees happen to be working the flowers at that time, so you kill all the bees. And you probably kill, I don't know how many nesting birds, and sicken the young fawns that are out there. You know, this is just, you know, and then it gets into the water, kills all your microbiota that you don't even see. Yeah. So that'd be the second problem. And then the other one is an exotic species problem. We got this parasite, a mite from Asia, from a different species of honeybee. They got into our bees about 30 years ago. And since the two species didn't evolve together, they don't have a proper parasite-host relationship. And the parasites can overwhelm the bee. In a world where people were all hands-off, that would resolve itself pretty quickly. What would happen would be the mites would probably kill off 90% of the honeybees we have, but there'd be a residual core that would survive. And they would be the ones doing all the reproduction, and pretty soon you'd have, you know, only the strong bees would survive and be present, and the most virulent mites would also die off because they're killing off their hosts, you know, right? And after a while, you come to a kind of a stability equilibrium. Problem is, we can't let 90% of our bees get killed off by the mites. You know, we're trying to make a living. You know, people need pollinators, right? So we respond the other way, and we come up with different interventions, most of them being chemical. There have been a number of compounds that have been found that you can apply to these mites, and it kills 99% of them. Guess what? 1% didn't die. Now, that's the only game, that's the only mite that's out there, and they're reproducing. And so now you've got 100% of the ones that are there are resistant to your chemical compound, right? So then you try to find another one. So what you're doing over a period of time is you're breeding a super mite. You know, that we're making them, we're helping them to evolve rapidly to be resistant to everything we do, you know. So, yeah, it's self-defeating. To the extent that you can find non-chemical interventions, that's the way you want to go. So and there are some promising things, you know, in the breeding, and the following the genetics, you know, you keep selecting the ones that are the most resistant. You know, we're making very slow headway. Maybe we'll get there, you know, after a while. But, we could have some kind of a breakthrough sometime, and all of a sudden it becomes just something we talked about in the past, you know, this problem we had. But right now, if you don't attend to the varroa mites that are in your bees are going to die. That's it. It'd be like, you know, some virus coming around with us, and if you don't get vaccinated, you know, you're going to die, period. So that's kind of where we're at. So if you combine those three little forces, the other problem, of course, with those mites is that they also carry a number of viruses that they vector into your bees. So even if you get rid of your mites, if you don't do it in a timely fashion and they've already infected your bees with viruses, well, then even if the mites are gone, they still got the viruses, don't they? So you take all these things and combine them, and it's like hooking somebody up to an IV with, you know, nasty poisons and chemicals, and, you know, just keep dripping it into them all the time. Well, you're never going to feel very good, you know, and you might stay alive. So this is kind of what bees, and not just our bees, pollinators in general, you know, wild bees, this is what they're faced with, a hostile environment, you know, toxic, you know. And then if you lose your variety of habitat, you know, so that, for example, if you're a bee, your protein source is pollen. If there's only one or two types of pollen available out there because everything else is getting killed with herbicides, well, I'd be like, you know, that you get broccoli, that's it. And you never get a yellow vegetable, or you never get any other, you know, it's fine. Broccoli might be really good, but if that's the only one you're getting, you know, sooner or later you're going to be, you know, your body's not getting the variety of vitamins or minerals, whatever you're supposed to be getting. You know, it's just monocultures out there. So you couple that with, you know, so poor nutrition, poison in your food that you do get, and then you got a blood-sucking parasite that's sticking its, you know, fusing viruses into you at the same time. Great. You know, people wonder why bees are having a hard time. You know? So it's pretty commonplace for beekeepers to have 30 to 50% of their colonies die one way or another over the course of a calendar year. So we can compensate for that, which we do. We spend a lot of time constantly raising more queens, starting new colonies, so you always, you know, keep replacing them. When I started keeping bees, before the varroa mites were here, and when the landscape had a little more variety in it, you didn't have to spend your time doing that all the time. In fact, there were so many bees, beekeepers sometimes in the northern states at the end of the year would kill off 2/3 of their bees and then take the rest of them down south somewhere, because they, you know, just, what are you going to do with all those bees? Because with the remaining third that you didn't kill off, you could come back and really easily repopulate and get your numbers all right back. Nobody does that anymore, I can guarantee you. No, now you have people blowing little weak colonies together to try to get one that's strong enough that you can send out to California and get paid to pollinate with. Yeah. So yeah, we're in a kind of a state of poor pollinator health generally in North America and most of the world. Yeah. But other than that, everything's fine.